I invite you to close your eyes, to sit comfortably, to breathe deeply, and build within yourself an expectation that God is going to speak to you in some way during this service. And it might be in the words of a song, or in a sermon, or in a prayer. It might be a thought that comes to you seemingly out of nowhere. But expect that God is going to speak to you in some way. Seek the Lord while he wills to be found. Call upon him when he draws near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the evil ones their thoughts. And let them return to the Lord, and he will have compassion unto our God, for he will richly pardon. Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you
in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. I invite you to stand, for great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. The Lord is our light and our life.
O come, let us worship.
Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his, for we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age. The Lord is our light and our life.
O come, let us worship.
I invite you to be seated for our first reading.
The first lesson is from Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 to 15. Joseph could no longer control his feelings in front of his attendants, and he called out, "Let everyone leave my presence." So there was nobody present when he made himself known to his brothers, but so loudly did he weep that the Egyptians and Pharaoh's household heard him. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Can my father be still alive?" His brothers were so dumbfounded at finding themselves face to face with Joseph that they could not answer. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer," and so they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. Now do not be distressed or take it amiss that you sold me into slavery here. It was God who sent me here, ahead of you, to save men's lives. For there have now been 2 years of famine in the country, and there will be another 5 years with neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me ahead of you to ensure that you would have descendants on earth and to preserve you all, a great band of survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God, and he has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord over all his household and ruler of all Egypt. Make haste and go back to my father and give him this message from his son Joseph. God has made me the lord over all Egypt. Come down to me. Do not delay. You shall live in the land of Goshen and be near me. You, your sons and your grandsons, your flocks and herds, and all that you have. I will take care of you there. You and your household and all that you have, and see that you are not reduced to poverty. There are still 5 years of famine to come. You can see for yourselves, and so can my brother Benjamin, that it is Joseph himself who is speaking to you. Tell my father of all the honor that I enjoy in Egypt, and tell him all you have seen, and make haste to bring him down here." Then he threw his arms around his brother Benjamin and wept. And Benjamin, too, embraced him, weeping. He kissed all his brothers and wept over them. And afterwards, his brothers talked with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The epistle is from Romans, Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 11. "I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. For I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people, whom he foreknew. Do you not know what the scripture says of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they too have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. For God has consigned all to disobedience that he might have mercy on all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached and said to him, "You know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said." He answered, Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit. But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then he said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please pray with me. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. We pray that you would help us to understand your word, and that that word, that truth, would be buried deep in our hearts and would grow and bear fruit in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, once again, we have wonderful readings this morning, and it's hard not to comment on all of them. Our Genesis reading, it's a good companion to the discussion we had last week about suffering. Here we see Joseph meeting again with his brothers after all the suffering he went through, and he looks back and he sees how God used that suffering to save many, many people by putting Joseph in the right spot that he could interpret Pharaoh's dreams and then save food for the coming famine. So it's a good reminder that our present suffering might be understandable from a future point looking back, even from heaven, looking back on our life. We might be able to see, oh, I see why that happened, or I see what that did. Maybe even not to our lives, but maybe 200 years down the road, there's some ripple effect that was caused by the suffering that we endured. So Joseph's story is a good lesson. It's a little bit of a foreshadowing of the cross as well, the suffering of the cross that brings salvation to all people, that God can take the suffering that we are endure and reshape it into something good. In our gospel and epistle readings, we see the ugly head of racism rising up, and we see that in our world a lot right now, lots of talk about that. And it seems to me to be a persistent problem throughout humanity across cultures around the world. And I think it is a natural thing that arises in us in our fallen nature. It seems like we are, the way that our brain is shaped, the way that our heart is shaped, we are looking for patterns that are maybe simplistic to help us understand the world. And so we use sometimes that's helpful, but sometimes that can also lead to using racist categories. And I am of the opinion that we are not going to become not racist by trying not to be racist. I think we're going to not be racist as a human species by believing something that is so much greater that it makes racism look silly by comparison. We'll dig into our readings a little bit here. And I want to say one comment about our epistle reading too, because that does comment on racism as well. So Paul is correcting some anti-Jewish notions that seem to have arisen. There's a type of thinking called supersessionism, whereby God is sort of done with the Jewish people. He's kind of completely rejected them, and it's only the Christians that he's dealing with now. That's what supersessionism is. And Paul corrects this view, saying that no, God's not done with the Jewish people. He hasn't swept them away. Right? So he says this, and Paul himself is Jewish, so he's writing this letter to the Romans. He says, "I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable." So Paul rejects any basis for anti-Semitism or supersessionism, any kind of racism against Jewish people is not permissible for a Christian, according to what Paul is saying. And we see racism within our gospel reading as well. And this time, strangely, it seems to be coming from the very lips of Jesus. And so we need to look at this. Jesus is Jewish. Of course, we know he's Jewish, and all of his disciples are Jewish. And a Gentile woman comes to Jesus asking for help. In case you don't know what a Gentile is a non-Jew. So the rest of the world is, unless you're Jewish, the rest of the world is Gentile. It means like the nations. And Jewish people of Jesus's time did not have a good view of Gentiles. And sometimes they would be called dogs. And in a Middle Eastern context, that was a severe insult. It's like one step up from calling someone a pig. You should know that in their culture, they didn't keep dogs really as pets. They were scavengers that roamed the streets eating garbage and whatever they could find. Sometimes they were vicious, and they were pests a lot of the time. Think of raccoons going through your garbage and hissing at you if you try to stop them. Like that's what a dog was in a Middle Eastern context. So to call someone a dog is a deep and severe insult. And Jesus calls this woman a dog. It's shocking. She comes to him asking for help for her daughter, and he calls her a dog. So we read, just to remind you, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." She came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." It's a shocking thing for him to say. But I think we need to look at this a bit deeper, because what's happening on the surface is not all that's going on. First thing that we need to remember is that this is the Gospel of Matthew. Who gave rise to the Gospel of Matthew? Well, Matthew was written in the context of a Christian community where they had overcome this barrier between Jew and Gentile. That was a big question in the early church. But they had overcome this, that they now accepted Jew and Gentile both as coming to Christ. They were both included in the church. Paul was busy in his mission spreading the gospel to the Gentile world, and this was well underway as Matthew was writing. So the kind of racism that was a part of the first century Jewish culture towards Gentiles was being overcome in the church in a massive way. Paul wrote to the Galatians in chapter 3, "So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." We sometimes miss how revolutionary that idea was for the ancient world that was so divided by ethnicity and family group and class and gender. So for Matthew's community, the church that Matthew was a part of, where Jew and Gentile are worshiping together, it would not make sense for Matthew to put a racist comment towards a Gentile in Jesus' mouth without there being a deeper meaning to that. So I hope that makes sense. There has to be more than meets the eye, because it would not make sense. It'd be a complete contradiction for the community of Matthew to leave that kind of a statement in the gospel when the community is completely not working that way. So that's the first point I want to make, is Matthew's community. The second part that I wanted to look at is that we need to look at what happens immediately before this interaction with Jesus and this Gentile woman. So I'll remind you of the reading. Jesus says, we read, "Then he called the crowd to him and said to them, 'Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles a person. Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart. And this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, and slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile.' Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon." So right after Jesus says these words about what makes someone clean or dirty, he heads into Gentile territory. I don't think we should miss that. This is the area that he goes into is where the famous Queen Jezebel from 1 Kings 16:31. That's where Queen Jezebel was from this area. And you might remember that she was a foreign wife of King Ahab, and she tried to promote the worship of a foreign god named Baal. And also the prophet Elijah, when he was escaping, he went into Gentile territory as well. And this is the area where the widow and her son were living when Elijah comes to see them and rescues them. And that's from 1 Kings 17, you can read about that. So the fact that Jesus heads into Gentile territory right after he gives this teaching, and in a gospel written in a time when Jewish-Gentile division is being overcome in Christian communities, that cannot be a coincidence. Like, those things should all be tying together and helping us to see if there's something else going on. Jesus' racist words, they expressed the normal thinking of a Jewish person towards a Gentile woman. So he's speaking the words of his culture, the expected words of his culture, or at least the thinking of his culture. And my suspicion is that Jesus is teaching his disciples something here about their assumptions. So the central teaching here that we should keep in our mind as we read this is, it is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles a person. It's 15:11 from our gospel reading. Gentiles were considered defiled. And partly because they didn't know Jewish kosher laws. They didn't follow them. They ate pork, for example. So according to Jewish table fellowship rules, you can't as a Jew sit with a Gentile and eat at the same table. It would have an effect on you that would make you defiled in a way. You couldn't walk into a Gentile's house without becoming defiled in a way. So, but the teaching that Jesus is giving here, he's saying that what defiles someone isn't what they traditionally thought made a Gentile defiled. Jesus is saying that a person's character transcends the group that they are a part of when it comes to issues of defilement. Character transcends ritual cleanliness. And these are rules that the Pharisees had put in place. And this is what Jesus is saying is, if there was a plant that was planted that wasn't one that my father planted, it will be pulled up. The Pharisees expanded their dietary and cleanliness and defilement rules that excluded Gentiles in a way that Jesus seems to interpret, saying that this is not the way that the Bible is meant to be read. So for his point of view, character transcends ritual cleanliness. So defilement is to be determined on the nature of your heart. So Jesus expands on what he's saying. Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, and slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile. So what defiles you is not your ethnicity, not your skin color, not your ritual cleanliness, and not eating pork. That is not what defiles you. What defiles you is a negative character, a cruel and sinful heart. One of the ways that we know if we have a deformed heart is through our speech and actions. These flow from the center of our being. So our heart is our character, is the place where we make choices. It is our free will. And out of that come our actions and our speech. And so if you want to know the state of your heart, you want to know the state of someone else's heart, look at their actions, look at their words. Murder, sexual sin, theft, lying, and slander all show what's going on in our heart. We want to know the state. If we want to know the state of someone's heart, then look at their behavior and what they're saying. Sometimes in the Bible, this is called the fruit. Look at the fruit. Are they speaking and acting in ways that are of the kingdom, that build people up, that express forgiveness and blessing, that honor God, that show compassion and love? Or are they speaking and acting in ways that cause division, that tear down, that cast judgment, that curse, that dishonors God? These are the things that matter, not our ritual cleanliness, eating kosher food, or skin color. And we might actually say, like in our own context, you can have a Jesus bumper sticker. You can say your prayers from your prayer book every day. You can show up at church every Sunday. But if you are a cruel person, and if you cause division and tear down and you're hateful, then no matter how religious you can be, you're still defiled. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. reflects this teaching in his famous line, "I have a dream that my four children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character." And I think he learned that from Jesus, I think. His culture was not living according to that teaching of Jesus, and he was reminding them. So let's look at this interaction between Jesus and this woman again. This Gentile woman comes to Jesus saying, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." So what do we see in her heart on the basis of her words and actions? What is her heart like? Her actions show that she believes in Jesus, that he can help her. So that's faith, right? She trusts him. Even today, in many places in the Middle East, men and women aren't really permitted to speak to each other in public, especially conservative places, especially a stranger. And so for a stranger who's a woman to come up to a Jewish man in a Middle Eastern context, it would make sense for Jesus to remain quiet, to almost act as if she's not there. That would be the cultural expectation. So he's mimicking the cultural expectation. But we know from other stories in the Gospels that this is not normal for Jesus. Jesus speaks to the Samaritan woman by the well. Right? He's alone. She's alone. That's not allowed. The widow who comes and touches Jesus' garment, and then she's healed. He speaks to her. The little girl in the bed, Jairus' daughter. She's 12. At age of 12, you're considered a woman, so he shouldn't be touching her. He grabs her by the hand and says, "Talitha kum." So Jesus is always transcending this barrier between men and women over and over and over and over and over. And yet here, he does something very out of character, which should make us think. And I think Jesus is trying to teach his disciples something. So he does what his culture says. He's quiet. He doesn't respond. So this woman persists, and she is willing to risk ridicule and rejection that would be expected as she publicly tries to seek this attention of this man, and a Jewish man at that. So she's crossing this gender barrier and an ethnic barrier, knowing that she is likely to get mistreated because she's not following the customs of the way that those people are supposed to be interacting in their culture. So she shows a faith that is willing to risk ridicule and mistreatment. That's the kind of faith that we need to have, right? That we don't just stop being a Christian because someone around us is going to make fun of us. She humbly comes, even in the midst of racist insults, being called a dog. Jesus is reflecting the thoughts of his culture for the benefit, I think, of his disciples who were looking at this interaction right after he gave his teaching about defilement. And she doesn't insult back. She turns the other cheek in a way. Right? She doesn't go away. She doesn't insult back, but she stays there in front of him. She humbly continues to come back to Jesus, even in the midst of ridicule. She also calls Jesus Lord, Son of David. And this is a messianic title. She's recognizing him as the Messiah. The Pharisees wouldn't address him this way. And so based on the actions and the words of this woman, what is the condition of her heart? Is she defiled or is she clean? She exposes what her heart is because she is full of faith that is willing to risk insult without retaliation. Jesus dreamed of a world where people were judged on the content of their character. And this was an important lesson for his disciples who were watching on. And it remains an important lesson for us too, especially with everything going on in our world. Amen. Well, I invite you to take a moment and consider what God might be saying to you through that reading and those readings, and expect to hear God in some way. To stand for the creed. Let us confess our faith as we say,
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our offering hymn is There is a Wideness in God's Mercy.
Thank you. Our prayers today can be found in the Book of Alternative Services, litany number 16. Let us pray to God the Holy Spirit, saying, Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit, Creator, renew the face of the earth. Come, Holy Spirit, come. We pray for your creation, which sustains us all. May we all be responsible stewards of that creation and do our part in healing our world. Teach us to be generous in sharing the blessings you've given us. We pray for the creation care ministry of this church. There is much suffering in our world because of injustice, exploitation, oppression, and violence. We pray that by your great might, you thwart all evil designs and establish your kingdom of love, justice, and peace. We pray for the peace of the world and those who are working for justice in the world. We pray for world governments and all those in authority. May they pursue truth, justice, and peace. Give those in power the wisdom and the will to work for righteousness. We pray for peoples everywhere affected by natural disasters, political upheaval, and religious terrorism. May all in distress be comforted and aided in healing and rebuilding. Come, Holy Spirit, Counselor. Touch our lips that we may proclaim your word.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
We pray for your church, especially the persecuted church and the church in places of conflict. Give your people strength, courage, and wisdom. We pray for church leaders. May they remain true to their calling. Today we pray for the Scottish Episcopal Church, the Most Reverend Mark Strange, Primus of the Scottish Episcopal Church, and Bishop of Moray, Ross, and Katniss. We pray for our companion diocese of the Windward Islands with Bishop Leopold Friday. And in that diocese, we pray for the Church of St. Paul, Kalekwa, and St. John Belair, and the Reverend Canon Ashton Francis. In the Calgary Diocese, we pray for Gregor, Metropolitan and Bishop, Pilar, and the Synod Office staff. We also pray for St. Andrew Calgary, the Reverend Christine Conklin, and the Honorable Reverend P. Lloyd Northcutt, and the Diocesan First Nation Ministries. Locally, we pray for our priests, Chris, Barb, Ethel, and their families. We pray for our church leadership and ask for wisdom as they work out the plans for reopening. We pray for the following people in the households of St. Leonard's and St. Paul's: Ellen D., Al D., Alan Janet D., Laura May, and Doug D. We ask you guide and direct them, protect them and their families from harm. Come, Holy Spirit, power from on high. Make us agents of peace and ministers of wholeness.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
We pray for our own governments and all those in elected office. Specifically, we pray for Justin, his cabinet, and other MPs in Ottawa, Jason, his cabinet, and other MLAs in Edmonton, Tara and her counselors in Red Deer. Give them wisdom as they make decisions for our country, province, and city in these challenging times. We remember our own community of Red Deer. We especially pray for the sick, the unemployed, the homeless, and the broken. May they find your comfort and healing. We remember other vulnerable people, specifically the poor, the lonely, children, seniors, and families with young children. We ask you give the most vulnerable what they need. We pray for care homes and other churches. Specifically today, we remember the New Testament Holiness Church Incorporated. We ask your blessing on all teachers and students of Red Deer Public Schools and Red Deer Catholic and Separate Schools. We pray that you give them wisdom with their reopening plans. Come, Holy Spirit, breath of God. Give life to the dry bones of this exiled age and make us a living people, holy and free.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
We give thanks for your healing work in the lives of members of the parish who are going through difficult times. In the hospital, we remember Norma. In our parish, we remember Dalton, Mary, Jim, Grace, Karen and Colin, Marie, Elaine, Don and Susan, Jean, Marion, and Roy. We give thanks for God's healing work in the lives of others who have asked us to pray for them. Lena, Addison, Velvet, Jody, Andrew, Pat, Des, Naya, and Dom, Carly, Anna, Denise, Sandra, McKenna, Carrie, Carol, Gerald, and Junior. We pray for those who are bereaved, Iris Liddell and family on the death of Brian, and the family and friends of Dr. Walter Reynolds on his death. We pray for those on our hearts today. Come, Holy Spirit, wisdom and truth. Strengthen us in the risk of faith.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
You commanded us to love our enemies, and we pray for them. We pray for the good of those who hate us. Lead us from prejudice to truth. Deliver us from hatred, cruelty, and revenge. Purge our hearts of fear, greed, and intolerance. Assist us with identifying and removing the idols in our own lives. You are light and life. Teach us to love you above all and our neighbors as ourselves. May our words be light and life to others. Purify our hearts. May we be a grateful people walking in your ways, doing what you have called us to do. And from the words of Romans 11, oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom and knowledge of you, O God. We cannot search your judgments. We cannot fathom your ways. For who has known your mind, O Lord? Or who has given you counsel? Who has given a gift to you, which needs to be repaid? For from you, through you, and to you are all things. Glory to you, O God, forever. Amen.
Please pray with me. Almighty God, you have broken the tyranny of sin and sent into our hearts the Spirit of your Son. Give us grace to dedicate our freedom to your service, that all people may know the glorious liberty of the children of God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And the general thanksgiving.
Almighty God,
Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And our final hymn is Shall We Gather by the River.
Thank you.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore.
Amen.
And the peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always.
Amen.